Okay, in this tutorial I'm going to look at the more advanced usage of macro parameters, including how to use text file includes, and also how to use things like places, and how to deal with macros that want to prompt for the same thing more than once. So the first thing I'm going to look at is files. Now, files are useful because basically there are some instances where the macro that you want to use is actually not necessarily longer than this box, because there's no limit on how long you can make a macro in this text edit box. But if you have a very long macro, it can be a bit of a nuisance to edit it all in one line and not be able to see everything that's going on, especially if it includes multiple messages or particularly when you come to edit script files. So one thing you'll notice that you have access to in multiple areas of the mod is this edit file option, which brings up this text editor screen where you can see existing text files that you've got, and you have the ability to create a new text file. So you can access this through the binding screen here, click edit file, and you can also get it through the main editor screen. So if you click down here, text editor, then you can basically access the in-game text editor through there as well. So if I create a new file, we'll call it test.txt. If you don't include the .txt extension, then the mod will add it for you. And so if we put in some text here, we can basically put in multiple different messages. So if we say hello there, everyone on the server, right now, which is basically just Chris Mac, but you know, he might feel special if I send him a message. And this will send four separate messages. So basically is the equivalent of separating the four messages that you want to send by using the pipe character in one macro. But obviously editing it on multiple lines like this is, one, a lot easier to read, and it's a lot more convenient for editing because you can copy and paste stuff quite easily. So yeah, it's obviously just much more powerful. So once we've got this text file, how do we actually insert it into a macro? Well, on the macro screen, so let's go back to B. You'll notice that at the very top here, it actually says use $ pointy brackets file.txt to include a macro file. So basically, if we type $ pointy brackets and our file was called test.txt. Now that turns yellow, and basically what it will do is it will insert the contents of that file, just as if we had typed it directly into this macro, but obviously it's just a much more convenient way of editing it. So let's click save, and so now when I press B, it's going to spam that into chat, hello everyone on the server right now, and you'll see it did it basically instantaneously. So that's basically a way of included. Chris Mac says go away. it's macro. That's quite useful. And like I say, particularly useful when you're editing complicated scripts and stuff like that. Obviously, it might be handy to be able to choose the name of the file from a list, and that's what the $m parameter is for. So if we let's make a new file first. So let's make a new file, and we'll call it gimme.txt. And in this file, you know how it works now. We'll just say I'll have give Mumfrey 4664 to give myself some TNT, because everybody likes TNT, and I'll also have I'll have a stack of torches as well, so 5064. And so now there are two commands in here, and remember this is exactly the same as typing them and separating them with pipe. And so now when we what we'll do is we'll change our B command to this $m. So now when I press B, it's giving me a list of files that I've got, and also the ability to create one right now. But I'm just going to run gimme.txt, and there is my stack of TNT and stack of torches. So obviously you can see that would be pretty cool, because I can I could actually just put a whole bunch of give commands in here. So let's say I wanted, all of the diamond stuff as well. So I think that's 276, 277, 278, and 279. I'd probably got the numbers wrong. In fact, I've just typed that in as the amount, haven't I? So we just want one of each of those. So you can see this is pretty easy to edit. And so now if I run that command and I run guinea, hey, I actually got the numbers right. So now I have a 64 stack of every conceivable diamond tool in the game. Let's get rid of those because that's just a bit hacks. Files obviously might seem a bit limited because you have to go out and edit them every time. But again, in combination with scripts, they're very powerful. But you can also include parameters within the files themselves. So if we change this gimme.txt let's say we want to change the amount of these that we've got. So let's get rid of the TNT and the torches, and we'll have a $$ amount parameter which we will put on the end here, and I can just paste that onto the end of each line here. And if you remember from the first tutorial, if you have a named parameter, then it basically will be inserted everywhere that it appears. So this amount will be prompted once, but will actually be inserted at all four of these places. So let's run this command now, and we'll choose gimme.txt, and it says amount. So if we put in 2, then we get 2 of each of those items. And again, just like normal macros, it remembers that number. So if we press B, choose gimme.txt, and choose... it's actually not remembered it. I know what that is. It's because that's kind of tricky to explain. But basically, so now we've got the ability to just run that macro and choose the amount of items that we want. So that if we just wanted 1, we can do B and then choose gimme.txt and type 1, and now we get one of each of those items. So that's pretty cool, but ultimately, still could be improved. So what we can actually do is when we run the macro, if I press B and run gimme.txt, then say we wanted to choose this amount from a preset list. Well, we saw in the first tutorial that basically what you can do is at the end of a name parameter here, you can put a list of options in curly brackets. So if we wanted in square brackets, so if we wanted to be able to have 1, 2, 10, or 64, then what it looks like we have to do is copy that down, because these are different. But basically, all you need to actually do is put the list options in the first instance of a named macro, of a name parameter, and it will be then copied to all matching named parameters throughout the rest of the macro. So if we press B, run gimme.txt, we've now got the option of 1, 2, 10, or 64. Let's choose 10. And it's given us 10 of everything because it inserted that value through the rest of the file. So sometimes there are going to be commands where you basically want to be able to include the same thing multiple times. But as you've seen, if you have the same parameter, it will be replaced the same everywhere in the macro. So something that might seem logical, and let's choose Y here, is TP and then $$U, $$U, which is teleport a user to a user. But of course, what I've shown you already is that if I choose myself here, then it's going to insert me at every point in the macro. This is where one of the compiler flags is really, really useful. So if I now run this macro, and let's say I choose myself, it teleported me to me, just as predicted. But what if I, if you notice when I press this, I've got an option here, replace all occurrences, which is ticked by default. But if I untick it and choose myself, I now get the same thing again, and I can now choose Chris Mac, and it teleports me to wherever Chris Mac is. Now, because Chris Mac is Chris Mac, he's on a giant cock and balls made out of TNT. That wasn't predictable at all, was it, Chris Mac? What does it say? Do I want to know? Great grief. I probably don't even want to know what this is saying. Everybody's playing Minecraft and I'm just... Okay, right, anyway. So moving swiftly on. Let's go away from the giant TNT cock and balls. Over to this delightful area of swamp, completely devoid of TNT cocks and balls. and just look at these macros again. So basically what we did there, and you'll notice now if we run that macro again, that this tick box that we unticked is still unticked, and that's because it remembers which ones you've unticked per macro. So that gives you a really powerful way of destroying big chunks of the world, apparently. That gives you a really powerful way of utilizing parameters dynamically, so you can have them replaced everywhere that you like, or depending on the type of parameter, have it prompt you for the same thing multiple times so that you can insert it different values at different places in the macro. So right, let's go and have a look what he's done to his Spider-Man. My heart bleeds for you, Chris Mack. Anyway, so yeah. What were we talking about? There was some point to this video, I think. Yes, parameters. So yeah, that's something cool you can do. Another thing is, server-side plugins support tplog. Let's just check whether this works. It might be tppause. Yeah, tppause. And tppause is a handy command, because basically if you don't have warp points, it's a really, really useful way of teleporting to a particular location in the world. Particularly if, for example, you know the coordinates of a place you've been but don't know how to get there, or don't have a warp point to get there. So that the format of this command is tppause, and then x, y, z, and optionally yaw and pitch. But there is a parameter that can help you out with this type of command, and that's the p parameter, which means place. So if we do tppause, and you notice that we can use $$p, and $$p will basically insert an x, y, z coordinate set based on coordinates that we're able to save in the macro. So for example, if I press N now, and I have the option to add a place. And it's put in the current coordinates that I'm stood at. We can see that those are the coordinates that I'm stood at. If we look at the debug screen, we're at -148, 64, 172. And if I press N, then and go out of place, -148, 64, 172. So if I make this place swamp, and add that to the list, so you can see now we've got a new place called swamp. If I teleport there, it's obviously just going to teleport me to where I am, but let's go warp back to one of our warp points that we had. So let's go back to test one. Then basically what we can do is, now if we want to execute that command, we've got a place that we can go to. So basically just like a warp point, but we can actually customize these coordinates. So let's say we wanted to know we want to teleport actually a little bit in the air, so we can change the y coordinate to 72, save that and teleport to it. And it's actually just the tppause command is smart enough to hit you on the ground anyway. But that's quite useful if for example you go somewhere and it ends up underwater or in lava or something. You could actually just edit the location. So let's walk back to test one, and I can again hit the same key, add a place, and use these current coordinates so that we know this is test one. And you've just got a really handy way of storing coordinates that you can use with other things. For example, one of the most useful ways of using it is like for mods like Minecart Mania that allow you to put the eject coordinates on signs. You can actually just use a macro that stores the coordinates. So if we do let's do J, can just basically go. We will log these coordinates, so we'll go log $$p. So if we do J, now we've got the option to add a place, we'll call this eject. And say we wanted then to have a sign over here which would have those eject coordinates in Minecart Mania format, so we just need to, let's go back to default texture pack because it's confusing. And we want a sign. Then we can actually just use place sign. And we will give it those coordinates again. And obviously, if it was minecart media, I think it's something like eject at, like that. So now when we press K, we can choose eject, and it will put that on the sign for us. So that's basically a really, really neat way of just being, you know, say you had a minecart station or whatever in Minecart Mania. Let's have some rail. So obviously, the if you put this sign under a rail block, then Minecart Mania will read that and treat it as an eject command. And say we wanted that the eject for this block to be over here, we can literally go over here, hit J, edit this place, and use the current coordinates. And then literally go back, place our sign using the command and eject, and it will use those coordinates that we stored. So as well as using TP pars, or even just using it as a way to remember coordinates, so you know, you're wandering around and you just say, oh, I kind of like like these coordinates. So you know, maybe you don't have access to any server commands, but just want to keep the coordinates. It's a really quick way of you going, oh, I kind of like the view here. I can just hit J, add a new place, I call it nice view, something like that. Add it, and so now when I want to remember where that place was, say I wandered off a long way away, I can just click on Nice View, and it spits out the coordinates in the console for me. I'll cover how to use you know, log and place sign and stuff like that in another tutorial, but you get the idea of how the parameter itself actually works, which is basically it just sort of sets of coordinates. There is a slightly more advanced way of using this, which is sometimes you may actually only want certain parts of the coordinates themselves. So say you know it's on the surface, so you know it's going to be roughly, you know, between 64 and 70. So you just want it to actually output the X and Z coordinates. Well, how do you do that? The easiest way to do that is basically you can alter the alter the macro here, so that instead of doing $$p, if you do $$px, this will just output the x part of the place, and then you can follow it with I don't know, $$pz, which basically says output the z coordinate. Now, just like any other parameter, if it appears multiple times, it will use the same choice from the list, but obviously just output different parts of that. Of that parameter that you choose. So if I press J and choose Nice View, it's just output the X and Z coordinate parts of that place. So you can obviously just customize this to your liking. So we say coordinates are X equals and Z equals. So now when we run that macro, it says coordinates are x equals minus 150, z equals 534, and we can use our debug display then to figure out which way that is. Or we can just use TP pars, which was on N, and teleport to Nice View. So lots and lots of uses for one very very simple parameter. So that's basically the advanced uses of parameters, and one thing you'll spot is that we're actually using the parameters inside a script here. The $$ curly bracket and curly bracket $$ actually designate this bit of macro as a script. And it's important to note that parameters are actually replaced before the script is run. So we could even have $$ question mark here, and This will be parsed before the script is even actually evaluated. So if we press J, it's going to ask us for a parameter, and if we say log, then it will log what we choose from the list here. But if we run the same command and actually say echo instead and choose Nice View, then it's actually inserted that parameter dynamically into the script and chosen what it wants to what to actually make it. So that's something important to note, because when we come to scripting later on, the interaction of scripts with parameters is something that will allow you to do some quite powerful stuff with the mod. So, well, that was spooky. Not sure what that was. So yeah, that's basically the advanced usage of parameters. You're now absolute experts and probably know more about it than I do. So thanks very much for watching. I hope you've got some useful information from this, and I'll see you next time.